Telecameras 3 and 4 working. Activate radio contact with the outside.
Love, wisdom, abundant life. Live a life filled with meaning, purpose, and a sense of accomplishment.
Can you hear me?
Welcome to the Teachings of Enoch. I'm your host, James Allen. Listen every week at this time on KKVV AM 1060 Las Vegas. You can listen online at kkvv.com, on your smartphone using the TuneIn radio app, or listen anytime at teachingsofenoch.com. You can contact me by sending a text message to 702-483-7769. That's 702-483-7769. Or online at teachingsofenoch.com. Let's get started with today's message. My guest today is Dr. Philip Dowell. He graduated from Cambridge University. He's superintendent of Rosalind Academy in Nairobi, Kenya. The author of Virtuous Minds, Intellectual Character Development, and we are speaking today via Skype. And welcome to the program, Dr. Dow. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
Dr. Dow, in your book, you talk about intellectual character, intellectual virtue, and one of the statements that you have in there is that intellectual character is like a bank. Can you elaborate on this idea? I just love that concept that you developed in your book there.
Yeah, sure. The way that I define intellectual character is that it's an accumulation of our thinking habits that we've developed over time, and that these thinking habits eventually morph into character.
In Proverbs, it mentions that get wisdom now, because if you don't get wisdom, when trouble comes upon you, it's going to laugh at you. Not that it's cruel, but hey, you've had all this time to store up this wisdom, but instead you've wanted to play the fool, and now when you need wisdom and knowledge to get yourself out of the predicament you're in, it's just not there. And I thought maybe this idea of intellectual characters is maybe what you were thinking of the same, along the same,
yeah,
the same term.
No, it absolutely is. And I guess to go back and to hopefully be a bit more concise, the concept of the bank was just the idea that our intellectual character is something that we're always pouring into. We're making little decisions every day, and each of these decisions may seem unimportant on their own, but over time we're adding habits, intellectual habits, hopefully virtuous ones, honest, courageous, curious, fair-minded thinking. To the degree that we're making little decisions that lead us in that direction, we're adding to a very healthy bank account of intellectual character. And when we come to make big decisions in life, and even little decisions, we're going to need to draw on that. And that was the concept that I was getting at. I think I used in the book the example of buying a house. And if I was to go in and buy a house the first time I've ever gone through the process, I could try to pour all my thinking, be as self-conscious as possible, be as good in my thinking as I possibly can be. But if I haven't developed a whole series of good intellectual habits, knowing to ask the right questions and to dig for the answers until I find them, tenacity and courage and so on, then I can think as hard as I want at that moment, but I'm going to have a bank account of intellectual character that's going to be overdrawn or lacking the resources that I need to make a good decision. So that's the concept.
And you bring out the idea of intellectual courage. What do you mean by intellectual courage?
Yeah, with all of these intellectual virtues, whether it's honesty or humility or fair-mindedness or courage, they're all attributes that should come, I wouldn't say naturally, but come to a person who is pursuing the truth, who values the truth over wealth and prestige and power and whatever else it may be. So intellectual courage is the attribute that comes to a person who's pursuing the truth, and they want the truth so much that they're willing to take risks in the pursuit of truth. An example that I give in the book is a third grader sitting in a math class who's confronted with a problem or a concept she doesn't understand, and she has a choice at that point. Does she raise her hand and admit to the rest of her classmates that she doesn't get it, or show the rest of her classmates that she's kind of an eager beaver and risk their kind of disapproval with that, or does she take that risk and raise her hand and ask the question and betray her ignorance? And at that point, that's that's a small but incredibly important moment in that third grader's life, because she's making a choice to choose to be courageous in her thinking, that will allow her to open, that will allow a world to open up to her that wouldn't have opened up otherwise. And if you take that one little decision and then expand that over time to 1,000 little courageous decisions that that girl makes, the difference between who she becomes as a result of intellectual courage and who she would become if she was the equivalent, I guess, of an intellectual coward is vast. If she's courageous, she develops confidence. She starts to see connections between things that she wouldn't have seen because she didn't understand the concepts. It just goes on and on. So intellectual courage is just one of the virtues that has just a massive knock-on effect in the rest of our lives as we practice them in the little ways. And as it becomes part of who we are.
It seems like those are, like you said, little building blocks. It would be easy to go the other way. Well, I'm not going to ask the question. I'm too shy, or I might get laughed at. And then that kind of sets a pattern the other way. Well, it's too hard. It's too difficult. I don't know what other people might think. And so you're kind of retreating. Am I understanding you correctly? You're really going the other way, and you're building the building blocks for that foundation of knowledge by being strong.
Yeah, that's one of the things that I try to highlight in the book as well, is that all of us have intellectual character, whether aware of it or not. We have habits that have become so ingrained in us that they're just our default settings in terms of our thinking. So that intellectual character can be virtuous or it can lack virtue. And the implications for our lives in terms of how we develop and grow are huge. So we all have intellectual character. Some of us are making decisions that are leading us in a positive direction, a way that honors God with our thinking. And some of us are making choices in our thinking habits that are leading us in a direction that's away from that.
If you just tuned into the program, my guest today is Philip Dow, and if you'd like a copy of this book, Philip Dow is the author of the book, Virtuous Minds, Intellectual Character Development. If you'd like a copy of the book, send me a text message. The first couple of people that send me a text will receive a copy of the book, and my text number is 702-380-8370. That's 702-380-8370. So send me a text message. If you're one of the first three to get me a text with your information, you will receive the book. We will be right back with Dr. Philip Dow.
Just to save his own.
interview today with Dr. Philip Dow. He is the author of Virtuous Minds, Intellectual Character Development. And we're talking about some great things, intellectual courage. We've discussed that. And Dr. Dow, intellectual carefulness, you mentioned in your work the Mariner 1 disaster. And maybe you can talk about that and how it relates to being careful with our intellect.
Yeah, there's a intellectual carefulness of all the virtues that I mentioned in the book. It's the one that would normally be seen as kind of the least important, or they're kind of the most boring of the virtues, I guess you could say. But in many ways, it's one of the most important. What intellectual carefulness is it's a character trait that comes to people who are so interested in the truth that they are willing to make sure that they're getting the details right, that they're not overlooking important aspects of whatever it is that they're learning about. And as a result, it has a huge influence on the way that they learn and the way that they study and ultimately on their lives. The Mariner 1 example is a great example of how the lack of intellectual carefulness can impact our lives. The example is that during the space race in the 1960s and 70s, NASA was going to put an unmanned spaceship to Venus and send a spaceship to Venus to do some research. And everything went very well. This obviously was years in process, millions of dollars in the preparation. And they launched the Mariner 1, and soon after its launching, it exploded. And, you know, $6-8 million, which in today's money would be a lot more, of course, went into the sea. And the question is, why did this happen? And as they researched this, they realized that there was a single detail in one of the codes that was programmed into the Mariner 1 that had been put in incorrectly. And as a result, the entire mission was destroyed. And what I did is I used this as an example of how important it is for us to pay attention to the details. Now, many of us, because of life and the busyness, and we're always going to get details wrong. But the point was that if we are making a habit of being careful in our thinking, that eventually we'll become people who are naturally intellectually careful. We won't have to think about being careful. It's just simply who we are. And the example with Mariner 1 was actually highlighting the fact that NASA wouldn't have got anywhere near the place where they could even launch Mariner 1 had they not had a culture of carefulness. Every detail mattered a great deal, and the success of NASA in terms of sending people to the moon and all the things that they did during that period was really a result of a culture of intellectual carefulness. And the Mariner 1 example was how one small a failure to be careful had a hugely negative impact, but it really highlights the very opposite, and that NASA was a success story. They had become a culture that was naturally careful in everything they did, and as a result, they were incredibly successful in their space program during that period.
And I think that their mission, when you think of that time period, we had, you know, the looming Soviet Union there and the missiles and the nuclear destruction just, you know, could happen at any time. And we're racing to get the best technology, racing to get the best missiles, racing to get the best space program. The pressure and taking that in into this kind of culture must have really been quite an experience to be in that culture there.
No, you're absolutely right. I mean, that's a great point, and one that I didn't actually bring out in the book, but it's very important. Is there would have been pressure to rush, and it's in those moments that the temptation to ignore carefulness is so high.
You know, on the other end of that, you have a great quote from Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who lamented that the media pushes guesswork, pushes rumors, suppositions to fill in the voids, and none will ever be rectified. They will simply stay on in the reader's memory. Of course, that happens all the time, especially here in the United States when we have, you know, whether it be a huge election, the last presidential election, or we had the recent bombing in Boston, the media is all rushing to get the first, you know, hey, we've got the guy, or this is the person that's been elected. And the credibility of these news networks has really been damaged because the things they report initially are usually false. And because they're in such a rush, kind of opposite from that intellectual carefulness, because they're in such a rush, it really ruins their reputation. But like Solzhenitsyn said, that idea sometimes stays in our minds. Well, you know, I heard it on the news that such and such happened, or this took place. even though it's not correct at all. And I know some of my friends who are kind of on the conspiracy edge will say, well, they shut that up or they quiet it down. And, you know, I just happen to believe, well, no, they didn't have all the facts in. And so they weren't being intellectually careful at all in this regard.
Well, you know, I mean, it's interesting that you mentioned that the last election and the Boston bombing. It's when you look at the media over the last, well, I mean, actually, you could probably go back as far back into the media, to yellow journalism back in the 19th century in America even. There's always been a temptation to try to get the story out, to get the scoop. And ideally, in the most kind of extravagant and impressive terms possible, because that's the way papers are sold, or that's the way people listen to your cable TV show, or whatever it may be. So there's a constant pressure, and the media is just one example, but there's a constant pressure for all of us to put other things ahead of the truth, whether it's our reputations or our egos, whether it's the pursuit of wealth, whether it's the pursuit of getting the scoop in the media, whether it's getting elected, whatever it is, there's always a temptation to put the truth to put other things over the truth. And to the degree that we allow other things to take priority over the pursuit of truth, is the degree to which we are going to be developing character traits, intellectual character traits that are going to have knock-on effects in every other area of our lives as well. There's a really good article. Time Magazine, for all of its flaws, had a great article in the build-up to the 2012 election, where they basically highlighted the willingness of both the Romney campaign and the Obama campaign to play on the fact that to put mistruths or half-truths or out-and-out lies out in the public domain, with the full understanding that they would never be called on it. And so it was an example to me of the crisis that our culture is in when it comes to truth and when it comes to intellectual character. They were cynical in the degree that they said, you know what, no one's going to, if they call us on it, as Solzhenitsyn said, the impression is already out there and the impression is what we want. That's what's going to ultimately win us votes. And what they didn't think about, or what they should have thought about, was the damage, as you point out, to the long-term credibility of the campaigns or of the politician, so it's a crisis that is deep-seated in throughout our culture, whether it's in education, whether it's in media, whether it's in politics, but it just highlights the importance of valuing truth. And I think that's, as Christians, that's something that should be absolutely central to our faith, is all truth is God's truth. And to the degree that we're pursuing that, we're honoring God with our lives and with our thinking.
Well, if you just tuned in, my guest is Dr. Philip Dow. He is the author of Virtuous Minds, Intellectual Character Development. And we are speaking via Skype. If you'd like a copy of his book, be one of the first couple of people to send me a text message to 702-380-8370. And if you're within the continental U.S., I'll go ahead and send you a copy of this book. Again, the text message number is 702-380-8370. We'll be right back.
Oh,
I'm talking with Dr. Philip Dow, and we are speaking via Skype. He's in Nairobi, Kenya. Dr. Dow is the author of Virtuous Minds, Intellectual Character Development, and we are talking about his new book about being intellectually honest, being intellectually virtuous. And one of your sections in the book, Dr. Dow, Intellectual Honesty, you talk about the disaster in science with the Piltdown Man, with Charles Dawson. Maybe you can recap for our listeners just a brief summary of what that was about and how that plays into your idea there of intellectual honesty.
Yeah, well, the Piltdown Man is a famous example of how scientists and a culture had a predisposition to wanting to believe a certain thing, and so they did. There's a sense of intellectual bias that went into that. The story is, this is early in the 1900s. One amateur scientist found or claimed to find the remains of one of the ancestors of humanity. He's obviously someone who believed in Charles Darwin's theory of evolution, and he believed that he had found, or he claimed to have found, one of the missing links. And there was a huge amount of publicity that was brought to this. The title of the person of the remains was Piltdown Man, and it became one of the hubs of evolutionary theory for many, many years, for about 50 years, I think. And it wasn't until about 50 years down the road that a couple people came along and said, you know, this doesn't seem to fit for a number of reasons. So they asked for the permission from, I believe, the British Museum to go back and do some analysis on the bones that were found by this gentleman. And what they discovered was that the bones were a combination of the bones of a monkey or orangutan and the bones of a human being that had been, in a relatively sophisticated way, put together to make one. And what it did was it just absolutely kind of shattered 50 years of research that had gone into evolutionary theory, because all the people that had come after this gentleman Dawson had based a lot of their theories on his finding, or his supposed finding. And the point of that example wasn't necessarily to debunk evolution, but to show how someone's pursuit or lack of honesty had a tremendously negative impact on everyone else who came after, because their theories were founded on his finding. And so all the millions of dollars and the hours of research that they had poured into that were in a sense wasted time because of the foundation that he had created in the pursuit of building a name for himself or advancing a theory that he wanted to be true. So the importance of intellectual honesty in that example is that it doesn't just affect us, but it obviously affects everyone whose understanding of the world is based on the claims that we're making.
Well, via Skype, I've been talking with Dr. Philip Dow. He is the author of Virtuous Minds, Intellectual Character Development, and Dr. Dow is in Nairobi, Kenya. Like I said, we've been speaking via Skype.
What's going on? What are they stopping for?
Love, wisdom, abundant life. That's my hope for you. You've been listening to The Teachings of Enoch. I'm James Allen, your host. You can contact me by sending a text message to 702-483-7769. That's 702-483-7769. Or online at teachingsofenoch.com. You can listen to this program every week at the same time on KKVV AM 1060, Las Vegas. You can listen online at kkvv.com on your smartphone using the TuneIn radio app, or listen anytime at teachingsofenoch.com.